Another way to deal with dynamical processes in non-equilibrium quantum system is to look at quantum channels, for instance. And this is what Michel described, so these include measurement processes, control, etc. Another strategy when you look at the non-equilibrium system is to look at the steady state, a steady behavior, steady system. It's steady, but it's out of equilibrium, so it means that it will be, for instance, driven externally by external parameters. And there is also, so one example would be to look at so you have a system, your system, and you have different reservoirs. Which interacts with the system. And there, again, there is different strategy to study such problems. Either you try to look at an effective dynamics, how you couple the system to the reservoir. And one way, for instance, will be to, so you just restrict the dynamic processes inside the system, and you encode effectively the effect of the reservoir on the dynamic. So and that's done, for instance, using also techniques that was introduced by Michel, so via Lindblad Markovian description. Which in quantum mechanics will be encoded into some Lindbladian. Or you may try to study globally the system and look at its unitary evolution, like what people do in quantum system, and somehow just observe the system and not the reservoir. So this is the strategy I will use. So I will look at steady states that are produced when you couple the system, and they are produced by the dynamic which englobe, which deal at the same time with the system and the reservoir. So the, of course, these two strategies are linked because, as I said, if you talk about non-equilibrium processes, or if you talk about a steady system, it's steady with respect to some dynamics. Of course, the dynamical processes code for some information on the steady states. And for example, you can also, once you understand the steady system, you can look at how this steady state is approached, how, for example, you will thermalize, or you will go to the non-equilibrium steady state, and that the approach to the steady state is, of course, coded into the dynamics and depend on the dynamics. So the what I am going to describe is how to deal with this approach using CFT tools in order to produce some steady states which are non-trivial and in which you can deal with system away from equilibrium and away from the linear response theory. So, so what we have in mind is we have a system. With two reservoirs. So one, this will be at some temperature. That's a reservoir. This will be at some temperature T1 and see where the temperature T2. So naively there will be a flow of energy from the from one reservoir to the other reservoir, so it's why it will not be at equilibrium. And what we will, in order to be able to say something exact and non-perturbative, we will assume that the system is described by a conformal field theory. So this is it's described by CFT, which means that it's a 1D system, which is critical. And in order to use a CFT tool at maximum, actually we will englobe all the system, the reservoir and the system itself in a CFT framework. So we will deal globally with all the system at once. So the way to and then what I am aiming at is to describe property of this transfer of energy. What are the fluctuations? What are the mean current? How it depends on the characteristic of the system? How it depends on the external parameters, etc. So in particular, all the fluctuation of the heat transfer will depend on the property of the steady state. So it will be a way to analyze the steady state by looking at the fluctuation of the heat transfer. So following Karalian strategy, I will divide the lecture in three parts. One will be an equilibrium CFT, and then the second part will be energy fluctuation. And the third part will be again a non-equilibrium CFT. But the first part, which is the simplest one, I will deal with the case where the system is invariant by translation, so it's a homogeneous system. And this one will be when it's inhomogeneous. And dealing with a non-homogeneous system will require to deal to use a bit more tools from CFT, so it will be a way for you to train on CFT. So the way I will proceed is by first describing the setup, then how to what I want to do. How to represent the steady state. How to construct the steady state. And how to use the steady state. So so what I have in mind is that I will prepare different quantum critical system, prepare at different temperature, and put them into a contact, so that one part of the system is at some given temperature initially, another part of the system is at another temperature initially. When you put them in contact, you have energy transfer between the two. So first, what is the basic property of conformal field theory, which will be the tool we use to analyze the system? So, conform with history, was maybe described by Giuseppe as a way to describe two-dimensional critical system, actually statistical model. So it's defined in a two-dimensional Euclidean space. I will use them in Minkowski space, which means one plus one setup space, where one refers to the time and the other one refers to the space. So what conformal field theory will be useful for is to describe the evolution of one-dimensional quantum system, which take place in some interval on the line, for instance. So the basic example is a free fermion. You know that if you look at free fermion in one dimension, you have some energy, some in energy band. So the energy as a function of the momentum, k. So k is a so k is the momentum. So you have some energy band, which is defined on the Brillouin zone in 1D, which is an interval, periodic interval on the real axis, on the k space. And you feel the if your energy, Fermi energy is somewhere here, you feel all the energy below the Fermi energy, and the low energy excitation, which is what we describe, will correspond to particle Hall excitation. You take a particle and you excite them above the Fermi energy, or you extract a particle, you create a Hall, or you add a particle close to the Fermi energy. So this means that in the low energy approximation, you have a linear dispersion relation for the excitation of the energy. So the energy of k plus, we'll say p plus epsilon f. This is linear in p, so you have same dispersion relation as for a relativistic particle. And you have two, there is two Fermi, the Fermi surface is consists in two points. So this means that as a consequence, the energy, the quanta of energy will be transported ballistically, either to the left or to the right. So on the real line, the energy quanta will be transferred either on the left or on the right, ballistically, okay? So this means that the energy density of your system, if you have in a given state, so I call it E, is the sum of two quantities which correspond to the transport of the energy by the quanta which move to the right or to the left, no? So that's that's for the energy density, just the sum of the energy of the density of the energy, quanta of energy, and the quanta of energy can be classified depending whether they move to the left or to the right. And of course, the momentum density is the difference of the two, t minus t bar. So these move to the left or to the right, which means that the fact that they move to the left or to the right translates to the fact that T minus T satisfy an equation like that, which means that T is actually a function of x minus T. So the density profile of this aspect 2T move to the left. So I'm dyslexic, I always mix left and right. So that's the basic property of a conformal field theory. You have energy move either to the left or to the right. And so the energy density is the sum of these profiles, which move independently on the left and the right. And the momentum is different, and they don't interact. So if you want to formulate it in a field theory, field theory formulation, T as a component of the stress sensor. So you have a stress sensor which is T mu nu. So that's component. Stress sensor is a two tensor. And the fact that you have this decomposition in left and right movers is linked to the fact that the trace of the stress sensor is zero. So that's the only property we will use about conformal field theory. That just you have such a structure for the energy density. So that's the property of the system we want to put in a situation where they are not at equilibrium, so there will be a flow. In order to prepare, as I said, in order to put ourselves in a situation where there is not equilibrium, we imagine that we prepare two copies of the system at different temperatures. So that was the second part. So set up again. So we have two copies of the system. I put the that one and that one. And they don't interact, they don't talk each other. So this one is at temperature T1. This one is at temperature T2. So they are at equilibrium. So this means that they are described by some Gibbs state, some density matrix, which is just given by the Boltzmann formula. And then, at some given time, T equals zero. We glue them. So we have that. So this means that here we had some we change the dynamic of the, which governs the evolution of the system. Because here we had some Hamiltonian, which was the sum of the two Hamiltonian, H, zero, which was S Hamiltonian for the left part, plus the Hamiltonian for the right part. And the state here was at equilibrium with respect to this Hamiltonian. And now we have a new Hamiltonian because there is some interaction here between the two systems. Okay. So we have H is H0 plus some delta V, which code for the interaction here. And then we let the system evolve. And as I said, during the evolution, necessarily there will be a transfer of energy from here to here. And what we aim at is to describe what happened in a domain which is close to the contact point. Okay? As big as we want, so it has to be a that's some size L observation. So it's as big as we want, but finite. So this means that from the point of view of the system, of an observer which is inside the system, the part of the initial conformal field theory behaves as a reservoir. So far away, this is equivalent to a reservoir. At temperature T1, and this is equivalent to a reservoir. At temperature T2. But the good point about that is that we put the reservoir on the system inside the same framework, inside the same description, and we can describe both the system and the reservoir in a unified way. So for example, to be concrete, an example would be take Heisenberg spin chain. So we take two spin chains, so it means that H0 will be, we have spin, we have a lattice, on the line, and we on each of the sides, we have spin SG acting on side G, acting on C2S. Then the Hamiltonian will be the sum of the two Hamiltonians, so there will be the sum on the left. So let's say that we label the site on the left by J negative, say half integer, so minus, smaller than minus 1/2, so minus 1/2, minus 3/2, and so on, with an interaction which is typically SG. So I'll take minus 3/2 plus 1 SG. So the biggest one is at position minus 1/2. And then the part that will be for the left part, on the right part, will be for G bigger than 1/2, SG plus 1. This means that here we have, if I wrote, we have the spin chain here. So that's minus 1/2, minus 3/2, nothing, 1/2, 1/2, 1/2, 1/2. So then we prepare the state, so we prepare again this one at temperature T1 and this one at temperature T2. So nothing happens. Yeah? Why? It has an infinite number of degrees of freedom because I take semi-infinite system. Can go as far as you want. No, when you it has a one mode per unit of length. No, it has, if you think about it depends on what you call mode, but if one mode is one quanta, there is an infinity of quanta. If you want, there is an infinite number of harmonic oscillators hidden in a SQL 1 theory. The usual way of one way to describe a bass in quantum mechanics is just you take an assembly of a large number of harmonic oscillators, as infinite, with any dispersion that you will adapt depending on what you want to describe. And that will be your reservoir. And you call it a reservoir because there is an infinite number of harmonic oscillators. In the field theory also, there is an infinite number of harmonic oscillators, of modes. Yeah? And why it's a reservoir? Because if you inject energy, the energy can flow far away and will never come back. That's why you want to, the reservoir has to be infinite usually. It's because you don't want a reflection of the flow, energy or whatever, on the boundary of the reservoir. Because otherwise, if you allow for reflection of the flow on the reservoir, you will have an the behavior will be, you will oscillate. Okay? So I prepare the state, these two spin, my system, which are decoupled, at different temperature. And now what I call gluing is just to add a link between the system. So here there was a missing link, I add it. Okay? So then it's again a spin chain, uniform one, homogeneous, but it was prepared in a bizarre state which was not homogeneous. Okay? So this means that H here is just sum over J. So it's more or less the same thing as what people use when they do local quench. They change locally the interaction of the system. Here we change the value of the bond here. But in quantum quench, people usually start with the pure states, which was the ground state of the initial Hamiltonian. Here we are going to start with the mixed states, the Gibbs states. Okay? So that's the setup. So now, as I said, we want to describe what happened inside, in some fixed domain, inside, close to the contact point. Because what we expect is that if we wait long enough, and the time we have to wait depend on the size of the domain in which we observe the system. So if we wait long enough, then we expect that what happened here is more or less a steady behavior. Okay, it will never be steady here because there is a flow, so the energy has to flow. But if you stay in some domain and wait long enough, you reach a steady state. Okay, and of course this domain has to be finite. And that will be the way to represent and to construct the steady state. Ah, yeah, it does. It does. Yeah. But nevertheless, the strategy is that you always look, do observation in a finite, in some domain. It can be as big as you want. And then you wait in order to reach the steady state. But if you have time to wait long enough, you will be able to observe on a longer part of the system. Okay? And the way it increases is very simple. So I told you that conformal field theory, you have left movers, right movers, the transport is ballistic. So more or less the energy is ballistic here. So this region where you have a steady behavior increases linearly with time. Okay? Yeah, but the CFT is supposed to describe only the low energy excitation. Yes, but then how can we have like high temperature on the left and low temperature? Yeah, it's true that you have to, if you look at the band, so there is a typically there is an energy scale which tell you where the linear approximation is good. So this fixed a linear typical energy scale. So the temperature has to be small compared to this energy scale. And then it's a difficult question to wonder if the CFT description is nevertheless valid in the away from equilibrium. So I am assuming that it's valid. And then we can discuss. And I will. So, but the interest of this exercise also is to try to construct non-equilibrium states and try to decipher what are the some property which hopefully may be general enough to be valid in other situations. Okay? As Michel said, there is no general principle for describing out of equilibrium systems. So if you have enough examples, then maybe you will learn something. Maybe. So how to represent the state? So as I said, we start with the initial state. That's the initial state. Which I call it rho zero. And this initial state is simply the Gibbs state, so it's proportional to exponential minus beta left, h0 left. And then we, so that's our the state we have here. And then we let the system evolve. So now we have rho of t. Which will be simply exponential minus t h, rho zero. And what we, the way, what I say that in the best of the world, we can hope that at last time we will reach a steady state. So we want to take the limit, we find the steady state, steady, as limit t goes to infinity of rho t. And then when we take the limit, we encode many data in the limit. In particular, we encode the initial external parameters because they are there. And we encode the fact that it's steady with respect to some processes. But then it's pretty clear that this limit will not exist in general. And you have to be careful in the way it exists. So first, if you start right away from an infinite system, you may have difficulty, so you may want to look at the system at size L. And then this limit will not exist if you fix L, because, as I said, the energy will flow, bounce back and be reflected by the wall here, and go back in the system, and you will oscillate. So the first, the limit can only exist if you first take the infinite size, the limit of the system of infinite size first. So, remark. So it should be, if you take the limit t goes to infinity after having taken the thermodynamic limit. In the opposite limit, you will never have a limit. So we have to deal with infinite system, which already in conformal field theory may pose sometimes some troubles. And then, again, you expect that if you want size as the limit as a meaning, you should observe in a finite domain, okay? So observing the finite domain is that means that you will use this density matrix to compute expectation of some operators. So it means that you, instead of two density matrix rho is associated the states on observables, okay, which I call omega. And omega on some operator is just trace of rho of O. So when I look at the time evolution, I have a state omega t, which depend, which is associated to rho of t. And then this limit exists only if this one has a finite support. It should not have infinite support, okay? So limit t goes to infinity of that may exist. Only for finitely supported observable. So, which just calls the fact that you observe locally the system. So now we will think, when we think about these operators, we just think about in this dual way, just in terms of states on some observable. And then we just want to describe the steady state. So we take the limit. So what does it mean that, so we have, so that's three. That was the preparation, that was a remark. Now we take the limit. So we have omega t of O, the same thing as the evolution of the system plus I t of some observable O minus I t h. Okay? We just time evolution h with h time evolution of O. But the state is H0 is stationary with the initial Hamiltonian. So if you look at this quantity, there is many oscillation due to when you introduce, for example, if you introduce a complete basis of states, there is many oscillating factors. So it has not a limit by itself. But because omega is commute with H0, it commutes with H0, you can insert H0. Okay, so I just took my operators and I say that omega 0 is invariant under the dynamic generated by omega H0. Okay? So that's an equality. Now, this one, introducing this factor, compensates all the oscillative factors. So now you may hope to get a limit. So this means that so you can take a limit of that one. And what does this contribution? So there is a time evolution with H, which is forward in time. And there is a time evolution with H0, which is backward in time. Okay? So this means that you get a representation of the steady state, which is, if I define omega ns, of O as the limit, as t goes to infinity of. This is simply omega zero with some S matrix acting on O. Which is just a limit when t goes to infinity of minus t h zero . Okay, and again this is time h evolution forward, and then in that order, it's important, H0 evolution backwards. Okay, so we have a representation of the steady states now. Okay, and that will describe potentially non-equilibrium steady states, and the non-equilibrium nature is again coded into the initial data, which tell you what are the external parameters, and the dynamic H. Okay? So why this formula is useful, especially in conformal field theory, is that we can compute this S matrix very easily. So that's the third part. So to construct the steady sets, we just have to construct the S matrix. So that's very easy. So here it's X, real axis. So that's the origin, let's say, where there is a two conformal field theory. So initially there was left conformal field theory here. What time is it? On here. And what we want, so we want to test, for example, for the energy in the steady states, energy fluctuation. So we insert, we have the operator T, X, or T bar. Let me take different colors maybe. T X here. Or T bar at another position. X tilde. And we want to compute product of expectation value. So we have to compute what is S on T. Okay. So at time, so we have, we do the evolution with, here we put T, another T here, and not here. So we'll see. So we do the evolution with H. But it's, I told you that when we glue the system together, it's, if I remember the example of the Heisenberg speech chain, it's again a conformal field theory. So it means that the energy density and the momentum transport, at least T, is transported ballistically on the left or on the right, depending if it's T on T bar. So for T, the evolution is on the light cone here. That's the H evolution. So if you wait a time T long enough, it goes very, very far. So I stop after some time T, and then I do with H0. So it goes back. So this means that S of T of X is T of X. At least when X is negative. Now I take T bar. So T bar was green, I take T bar. And I evolve T bar with first the H dynamics. You go straight along the light cone, but in the other direction. So that with H. And I wait for a long time enough, and you see the time, I wait for a time which is bigger, which is such that, which is bigger than X, or V times a time T such that X is smaller than, in absolute value than V times T, where V is the Fermi velocity. So this means that I wait long enough such that I cross the contact point. Okay, because I have to take the limit. And then I go backwards with H0. So again, I move here along the Lycon. But with H0, the two systems are decoupled. So the energy is reflected on the boundary. So I go back here. Okay? And of course, it's a symmetric position. So it means that S of T bar at X is T bar at minus X for X negative. And of course, that's the opposite if you are on the left. On the right, if I start with T somewhere here, I will evolve here and then be reflected. Whereas if I start with T bar, I will go in that direction and go back at the same position. So at least on any product of S, I have solved completely my problem, and I know the steady state. It's fully characterized by that. And you see that at the end, what it means that if I take, for example, T bar, here initially I have a T bar which is on the left, but after action of the S matrix, it's on the right because minus X is positive. Here it was already on the right, it's on the right. So the S matrix put all the right moving on the right and the left moving on the left. So why is it, so as I said, this fully characterizes the state omega steady state. And for instance, you can use to compute, for example, the flow of energy. So that will be the third one, B. So imagine I want to, so what is the mean energy flow? So the momentum is P. Is P, so the mean energy flow is a expectation of the momentum. So it's omega of P of X. And it has to be the you want in a steady state. So by translation or invariant, this is independent of X actually. And so this is the same thing as steady of T of X minus T bar of X, which is the momentum. So it means that the mean flow is omega zero of S of T of X minus S of T bar of X. But I told you the S matrix put all the left movers on one side and the right mover on the other side. So for example, text X negative. So this is omega zero T of X, which is on the left. Minus omega zero T bar at minus, which is on the right. So if you want to know the mean energy flow now, it's just a computation in conformal field theory at a given temperature. So this is at temperature, I said T1. This is at temperature T2. So that now it's not a computation in a non-equilibrium conformal field theory, it's a computation in an equilibrium conformal field theory. Because omega zero is a Gibbs state, and T is just one of the field of the quantum field theory, of the conformal field theory. So now there is a formula that I am sure I will explain it, that tell you what is the mean energy density in a conformal field theory at a given temperature. This is just all from conformal invariance. And that these are proportional to the temperature square. So this means that this is T1 minus T square. Just from conformal field, usual conformal field theory. And there is some coefficient, proportionality coefficient, that is written usually over 12 times C. And this proportionality coefficient is what is called the central charge of the CFT. So if you put the coefficient back, you have a H bar here and K Boltzmann here. And you see that this coefficient is completely universal. That's universal. It means that it's completely independent of the detail of your model. It just depends on the low energy characteristic of the low energy theory. In particular, it's independent of the Fermi velocity, which is, for example, not the case of the finite size correction in conformal field theory. So it's more universal than the finite size correction. So before the break, I wanted to make a few comments about which I forget. Which will answer Filippo's question. So, as you see, the way the steady state is constructed, it means that there is a Lyconne effect. That if you look at the system, which is similar to what happened in quantum crash. So if you look at your initial system at initial time, so here it's time. And here is here is the left. And that's a Lyconne. If you look at the finite time t, so it's supposed to be symmetric. All the domain which is inside here, as soon as you are inside the light cone, you have reached a steady state. So here it's a non-equilibrium steady state. And here it's the state, the Gibbs one, G2 Gibbs. So this answers your question. That means if you can only wait for a time t, you will be in the steady state if you are inside the Lyconne. So if you are observe system at a distance smaller than t in units where Vf, velocity is one. So of course this is a consequence of the CFT description. So if you have, surely if you include the bound correction, this kind of things, you will distort. You will change the way the Lyconne is, and you will distort. You will have a transition region here, okay, at best. Okay, what I wanted to say. Now, another remark maybe is that this T square dependence of the current is an echo of the fact that the transport is ballistic. as well as this Lycon effect. And that was measured, this was observed experimentally by in some quantum dot system. So it's a bit difficult to do measurement of heat transport, and but they managed to do it. So and this so this means that at least if the size of the system is small enough, so the transport is ballistic inside the size of the system, experimentally you have a proof that the CFT description is correct. But the size of the system has to be small enough. And actually the T-square dependence was predicted long ago for free fermion by Imri. And I forget the date. Okay, that's all what I wanted to say before the break, but maybe you have a question? No? So we can break. 10 minutes? Okay. So now,
may I ask a question?
Why?
So if I repeat the argument for two different conformational theories at the same temperature,
yeah,
then I get the same formula with C1 minus C2.
I know that this is what you get. You get.
Yes.
I will show you this is not the case, I think. Hmm? So if you have two different conformal theories, that was it's not homogeneous. So you have to be more careful. That was what I was planning to describe. Okay. So here what I so either I do it now or it will come. So I was planning to describe fluctuation. So, but since Andrea asked a question about the case of two different conformal fissure, I think I will be very, very short and just give you this section as a exercise. So here we have transfer. What is the problem? So, or the question. Once you ask a question, then there is a problem because you want to answer it. So, there is transfer of energy per unit, at least during any time duration. When you are in a steady state, there is some transfer of energy from the left to the right. So this means that you transfer an energy delta E from left to right. During time t. So this dependent t, put it here. And you know that there is fluctuation due to there is quantum fluctuation and thermal fluctuation. But in mean, we know that in min delta it bar, which is the same thing as omega n s of delta t e, will be equal to t times the mean current. Okay, so we know the mean, and we may be interested in wondering what are the variance, what are the higher cumulants, in order to have a better understanding how you transfer the energy and a better description of the steady state. You know, there is, at least in classical systems, there is a tendency to say that if you look at property of this of this cumulant, this will help you to find what will be the analog of the free energy, but for non-equilibrium steady states. Okay, that's what all the people are trying to do in, for example, in model system of classical non-equilibrium system like the TASEP and so on. So the question is, what are the cumulants? Of course, they depend of time, and what you expect is that they have a better behavior when you look at the property at large time. So this means that you are already in the steady state, but there, inside the steady state, you observe how much energy is transferred during the time t. Okay. So to quote the so this means that you may introduce a generating function for the cumulant. So you want to, for example, you introduce a parameter, delta e of t. And that you compute in the steady state. Well, this is just a formal parameter. So if you expand in power of lambda, this will give you the cumulant. So if you take the log of that and expand in lambda, it will give you the cumulant. Okay. So what is expected is that this is, if you take the log, so the cumulant will be linear in t. Well, if you look at the first term, it's linear in t. Okay. But the variance will also be linear in t. And then time a function when t is large. Okay. So this is function is a generating function of all cumulants at large time. So that's it's called the large deviation function. Okay. So better definition would be to take the log of that, divide by t, and take the limit. So better definition will be you take the log of that, so this means that you don't have that anymore. You divide by t, so you have f, and you take the limit. Okay, so that's what you want to compute. And so this function is a has good property in classical system. In particular, it satisfies fluctuation relation. F satisfies fluctuation relation. Which are called the Galavotti-Cohen relation. And these relations are generalization of the dissipation fluctuation relation. So it tells you that F is symmetric. F lambda is the same thing as F. Of I beta L minus beta L. And this relation more or less comes from time reversal symmetry. That means that you implement time reversal symmetry knowing that your steady state breaks the symmetry, but the dynamic was not breaking it. And that's by playing with the time reversal symmetry that you deduce that relation. So we expect that this is also true in the quantum case. I think it's not fully proved in general, but at least we expect it. And here it will be satisfied. And actually you have a stronger result which tells you that this function f is fully determined by the mean current. So here we have that if you take that f determined, fully determined if you take, so as I told you, the first term is the current, right, when I expand. So if I take the derivative of f at lambda, it starts with the current, okay? And then plus extra term. And the formula is that this is, so the current depends on beta left and beta right. And I will do a mistake in the sign. So this means that once we know the current in that case, because we have extra symmetry more than time reversal symmetry, because actually we have no reflection, just transmission, we have this property, and so all the higher cumulants are fully determined. So we know fully the statistics. And the statistic is, again, universal. It only depends on the central charge of the conformal field theory and the fundamental constant, Boltzmann constant, and h-bar. Okay, so the exercise is just to prove that. Just by there is no computation to do, just playing with the symmetries. Actually, I forget the proof, but so, but then I will not try to find the proof, just to answer Andrea's question. So, let us look at more general, so non-equilibrium CFT homogeneous. So what we have in mind again is we want to describe something like we have here some conformal field theory and here and then another one and they are different. So that's two. That's one, and CFT1 is prepared at temperature T1, and CFT2 is prepared at temperature T2, okay? Because they are not the same, it's not like in the example we had with the spin chain, when they were glued, it was uniform, and again, a unique CFT. So necessarily, there is some defect here. Something happened here. I don't know what it is, but there is some kind of defect. And why there is a defect? Because since it's not homogeneous, if we think about the energy flow will move in that direction. Of course, it will go in the other domain, but there will be a reflection also. Okay? Because there's some kind of all, and even if this conformal field theory was trivial, there will be a reflection. So we have to, and if there is a defect, this means we have to This defect describes the way we glue the two theories. So we have to see how we can, what kind of condition we can impose on this gluing procedure in order to describe the system. And if we don't know, then we will not be able to describe the steady state, and we will not be able to answer Andrea's question. So the first things I want to try to find is what kind of constraint I have on the defect. And the way the defect will be encoded into the system, so the only way it can be is via the dynamic, because if we look at the strategy we had the state omega zero, which was just Gibbs, and then we produce some non-equilibrium state, steady. And the way we produce it, what are the data which come here? It was H0, which describes what happened when the system is not coupled. So that was known. So it was on H, which is what happened when they are glued together. So the defect, we define what is H. So it means what is the dynamics. So first thing that we made to impose, that's a choice, which corresponds to Andrea's setup, is that there is no dynamical degrees of freedom in the defect. Because there could be, if you have in mind a quantum dot, there will be some kind of leads, CFT, a quantum dot, with some degrees of freedom, another lead. That will be a more difficult problem than the one I am going to study, which is just we glue the CFT together, no dynamical degrees of freedom. Okay, so if you want, the defect is just, will just specify the boundary condition here between, which tell you how you glue the field on the left and the right. Okay. So if there is no dynamical degrees of freedom on the defect, it means that the energy has to be conserved inside the system formed by the two CFT. So the first constraint is energy conservation. So what is the energy? The energy is, I will call it E, is integral of the energy density. No? And it's the sum of the energy on the left and on the right. Okay. So it's from minus to zero minus plus zero plus. Okay, just a way to write that I integrate over all the system. So now we have, so that energy at time t is that. And as I told you, E is E of x is t of t and we have the momentum t of x, which was t of x minus t bar. So I assume that the when I am in the bulk of the two systems, it's still conformal invariant. So the transport of the energy of T and T bar is ballistic. So only something special happens at the contact point. Okay. So I wrote dE over dT. Okay. And I want to impose that this is zero. Then we have so we have the conservation law. So away from the origin. So we'll have contribution from minus far away, far end of the two system and from the origin, okay? So let's forget what happened at infinity, so it's too far to see it. So we have this implies that we have contribution from zero plus minus, which tells simply that P at 0 minus should be equal to P at 0 plus, okay? Flux of energy is continuous. So that's the same thing as T. Okay. So that's the one constraint we have on the dynamic, that it should preserve, you should satisfy this condition. Okay. Yeah. First, it's true that if I had a bond, so I had a link which carry an energy which would be very large, but it doesn't mean that I add energy into the system. My system is just in the state omega zero, and then it evolves. No? And then, anyway, even if I add energy at time zero, initial time, then I do nothing after one microsecond. So after one microsecond, I should satisfy that. No? Okay. Okay, so that's the only information we have on the defect. So now, let us look. So that will be, so that's energy conservation, and that will imply conformal invariance. That's what in code Cardi relations. So that will imply conformal invariance. But it's a bit tricky if you think about this formula, because when we describe quantum mechanics, we have the system which we have time on the system, and all the observable act on the system which are in the one-dimensional line, okay? So what we know, the data we have, are the Hilbert space associated to this conformal fissure, or the observable, which are localized at different position x, okay? And then we may try to evolve. Well, this condition is at the fixed position here, at 0 plus 0 minus 0 minus 0 plus, at different time. So if we want to, so we need to transfer the information that we have here into a transformation which acts on the operator algebra, which is the data of the conformal fissure, okay? So it's not directly the Cardi's relation. That's a subtle difference between Euclidean conformal field theory and real-time conformal field theory, for those who know the Euclidean conformal field theory. So now, how we describe the dynamics? So that was energy conservation. Two is how to specify dynamic, which alias the defect. And then when we have specified the dynamics, we'll be able to see what is the constraint, what this constraint imposes on the dynamic. So again, this is very simple. So we have R, and we have time. And how we want to define the dynamic is not on states, because I don't know what they are, but on operators, on observables. So I use a Heisenberg description. Okay. And my states are, my observables are just fields localized at different positions, okay? So I have fields at different positions, here, here, here. And in conformal field theory, I told you that everything is ballistic. So either it moves to the left or to the right. And observables are product of observables which move to the left or to the right, okay? Everything decomposes into left or right movers. So now, so this one is either phi of the type phi or phi bar, which means that the phi move in that direction, on the five bar, so I took two colors last time. So the phi, or phi bar. So phi move in that direction, and phi bar move in that direction. So if I want to specify the dynamic, I want to specify the dynamic of the Cartwright field phi. So if phi is here, it will move along the light cone. So that one is done. Okay? Just it moves. Then this one, since that was my contact point at time, at some point it will hit here. And then I don't know what to do. But by evolution, it has, so it will evolve a little bit, and then it will, after evolution, it will become a field in the conformal field theory again. So, only possibility is that it becomes a linear sum of operators which move again to the left or to the right. Okay? So this means that to define the dynamic, we have to specify a map, so the, or the defect, that will be a map, which I call theta, and which is from what? Theta is a map from left movers, so I call them where is the yellow? So that was, that's a space of the phi bar operator, I will call them V bar. And this one, I call them space V. So that's the space of the operator, just a collection of operators. So this means that if I take an operator V bar on the left of my system, so that's the left part here, I am on the left, I hit the boundary, I got something which is linear combination of product of operator which is in the V space on the left and the V bar space on the right. So something which is V bar right tensor V left. But I can do the same thing here if I take, start with an operator here, if I am a V bar like operators, nothing happened, it's ballistic. And a V bar, it will hit the boundary. And if you take two symmetric positions, they will hit at the same point. Okay? So you need to specify a map which is from here to here. Okay? And that will define fully the dynamic. Okay? Because now, when I take any operators, I evolve. If I don't hit the boundary, nothing happens. If I hit it, I just apply the map, and then I evolve again. So that's my choice. But it seems that there is no much choice. And then you have to constrain that, because you can do it for T also. In particular, if you take T bar here, I can choose T bar. And T bar will be something linear combination of other operators. That will correspond to reflection of energy on the defect. But as I said, this is a relation which is at fixed position, different time, whereas my space here are at fixed time, T, some space-like slice, on which I define my Hilbert space, but different position. So you have to transform that equation. Okay. And then you have to know a bit the structure of that space, this space V and VR. So there is now two information. Second step is so the first thing that start just by using the ballistic transport can be impose a condition on T. So that implies some relation like T of X on T, So first I can write it. I will put plus everywhere because I don't know, I always do mistake with a minus. Okay, I just do, I move that to the left and that to the right. So, if x is 0 minus, that will correspond to that. If x is 0 minus, this moves to the left, so that will be x minus t. Well, this one is x is 0 minus, it's here, so it moves. So it's t bar x plus t. So that's a relation which is true for x negative. Ballistic transport, that it's you can show just by using this equation on ballistic transport, that is true for any x now. Okay, so now we have a relation for any x. And you see the difference between the relations is that here it's the time evolution of the operator localized at t, where this is a t operator localized at x minus t, which is in my algebra, but at different position. Okay. And now, here comes conformal field theory. So that, yes, there was no more than ballistic transport. Now you take, this is conformal field theory. So V in conformal field theory, you will learn it, are not anything. They support a representation of the Virasoro algebra, which means that V is a collection of operators. And so in V, you have some operator, which I call V of Y. You can look at what happens if you take two operators, X and Y. So that's a new operator in the algebra. So that's a linear combination of, that's a linear combination of basis vector, which means operators in V. And the way this is organized is by the fact that actually there is an algebra which acts on this operator, which is the Virasoro algebra. And so that will become more. So this linear combination is organized by the Virasoro algebra. So it means that you have, what is the Virasoro algebra? It's a Lie algebra with generator are called Ln for any n. So you have some Ln. So it's generated by the Ln. And it satisfies that some commutational relation which are of this form. Doesn't matter much. There is the C, the 12 that we have seen before, and what it is. So there is this Virasoro algebra which acts on that space, that space, that space, and that space. So we have a collection of Ln. We have the Ln L, the Ln right, Ln bar L. Ln bar right. And then this Ln appears here. So when I say organized in terms of Virasoro algebra, it means that this object can be written in terms of the Ln. So we will see that in the lecture by Giuseppe. So this means that now if I have this relation, I can multiply this relation by some operator phi, and then it has to be compatible with the Virasoro algebra. And using the fact that the product between the t and the phi is organized by the Virasoro algebra, I got, when I look what happens with the time evolution, I have a constraint between theta and the ln. Okay? You understand the logic? You just look at the product of the t with, so what you look at t of, or this relation, t phi x, and then you evolve in time. time evolve. And you can, actually what I will do that. I will look at tx plus t minus x. So that's something which is organized by the Virasoro algebra. And then I can time evolve this relation on its organized version. And because time evolution implies action of theta, I got an information between theta and the organization, which is the ln. Okay? So the relation is simple. It just says that theta commute with the ln, actually. Okay. So that's the condition for conformal invariance in this picture. No. So that's we spent a year understanding why. Yeah, we don't. Because actually, so we are in a Euclidean time formulation, which is a bit different from the real time formulation, which is a bit different from the Euclidean one. And we don't have temperature because we don't have the same temperature. Or if you want, it's a bizarre time because on the full system, first in the steady states, we don't have any more temperature, asymptotically maybe. And in between, we have in some domain, we have temperature, but it's not the same. The geometry is not a cylinder. It's just asymptotically a cylinder, if you want to be in the Euclidean. For doing what? No. We cannot put, I don't know how to put it. And we need a real-time formulation in order to find the steady state. Because if we use this real-time formulation to keep track of the external parameter, which are the temperature and so on. Okay, so yeah. But you see, you cannot. Yeah, it's time dependent. So you can formally write expectation in omega zero as a path integral on the cylinders, but then you have to time evolve the cylinder, which will deform the geometry in a way which is not really clear. And then you will, in the best of the world, you will have an asymptotic geometry describing the steady states, but you take the cylinder, you time evolve it using this dynamic, and you have something. Yeah, something. Okay, so this defines completely the model, so I forget something to give two examples for that. We have to define two dynamics, H0 and H. So now we have set as a problem. We have we have to define H0 that will correspond to some theta of zero and H which corresponds to some theta. So when you look at this solution, there is two simple solutions which I should have said before. There is one solution where you demand that this is equal to that. So first solution that is equal to that and that is equal to that, okay? So that will be T no, that equal to that, and that equal to that. T bar 0 minus T and you see what happens is that you decouple completely this theory. It means that when the energy arrives to the left, it's reflected. When it arrives to the right, it's reflected. So that was corresponding to H0. And then it just means that you decouple the theory. Theta is intertwined that und that und that und sich dahinter von that und that. And then there is another trivial solution, which is the one I used before, which was T. There's too many T bar here.
No bar.
No bar here, huh? There's this one and that one. And that was purely transmission. And for this to be, so that was what I used before in the homogeneous case. And that means if you look at the statement that theta intertwines the Ln bar with the Lr bar and the Ln with the Lr, and that possible since it intertwines, it's also possible if the representation are the same. So this is only possible if the two conformal field theory are the same on the left and the right. So in general, when you have two different conformal field theory, you have to find intertwiners of theta of the product of the representation. So that will be intertwiners. So why it's an intertwiner is because on that space, so here I can act with the Ln. Here I can act with the Ln with the Virasoro algebra. It's a Lie algebra. So when you act on a tensor product, it acts additively, like SU2 on that addition of the angular momentum. So that's an action on of the Ln on that tensor product, defined by the action. So here I have what it means that theta commutes with a global action on that space. That's what it means, the intertwiners. So every time you have an intertwiner, you will have a defect on the dynamic, on a new steady state, and the steady state on the dynamic will depend on that intertwiner. So it means that now, and then you will produce all the constructions. The S matrix would be simply written in terms of the theta. You take your field, you evolve it with the H dynamic, which depends on theta, and then you go back and you define the formula. So you can repeat everything, and hoping that you can compute things interesting and understand what is the property of these steady states. So now that's the general framework, and then I want to answer your question. I have to find one example of C, of theta, and try to compute the mean current. So how you construct theta? So the modular, so the set of possible theta, which I call the moduli space of theta. What are they? So they have to intertwine the algebra. So here you have some algebra of operators. Okay. So so it means that theta has to be an automorphism of the algebra VL times VR. But I choose the one where they are isomorphic. And then, but if it's just an automorphism of each of them, that will be a trivial action. It will be no dynamic. So you have to find, consider the product of the operator algebra, K1, and look at all the automorphisms of them. Well, so that's the modular space. So now it's, in general, I don't know what is this space. It's a bit difficult. But you can give an example. So for example, what you can do is that you take on the left, example, you take on the left, so CFT left, which has a Kawal algebra V left. I take it, suppose that it has a symmetry group H, okay? Okay, just H. Take, for instance, U1. And then you will choose as a CFT on the right, some algebra V. Search that, so you choose them, such that VL times VR is invariant under a bigger group. Okay? Then you can, if you can find some search conformal field theory, which will extend the symmetry of the initial one. You will have a bigger symmetry which is not part of the two, and you can take any of this theta and define a correct dynamic. Okay? So there is one example for the zonal which are called the coset. So that has to be the coset of G over H, because when you multiply G over H times H, because I can simplify G over H times H is equal to G. And this is true for group two. Okay? So that works. For instance, you take here you take U1, here you take what is called ZK, parafermion, so something which is has a parafermionic statistic more general than the fermion. That will be invariant under SU2. And you have a dynamic on U theta. If you take any group element in SU2, you produce a theta. So you produce a dynamic, so you produce a steady state. Okay? And in all the cases we know, so in all cases, all non-cases, so I don't know in general, but in all cases, G is proportional to some coefficient pi kb 12 t1 square minus t2 square. So this one has different central charges. This has c equal 1. This one has c equal maybe something like that. For k equal 2, it should be 1/2. Okay. So it's always proportional to the difference of the square of the temperature. It's not modulated by the c. And I think, so I don't have a proof, but if the state are prepared at the same temperature, you don't believe to have to produce a net current. So the current has to vanish when T1. Yeah, it's what I was saying, that it was finished. Otherwise, the entropy production will be, that ensures that the entropy production is always positive. Otherwise, you will break, yeah, exactly. So it's not true. So I know that you have a statement somewhere, yeah, C minus C bar, but I don't understand, at least in that framework. Yeah, you say no? Probably, yeah. But it should be, there should be some general statement about what can be transferred between two conformal field theory. Yeah, I know that's okay. Maybe. Yeah. So to answer your question, no. Yes, we need that. Okay. Which I agree with. So, but to answer your question, if you have two different central charges, C1 and C2, the current is still proportional to the difference of the square of the temperature, because of, as Michel said. I think. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, but it depends. You know, even if you have the same theory here, you can have a non-trivial theta. Imagine that you have two fermions here. You can have reflection here, and then the current will depend on the reflection coefficient. So this coefficient depends on c and on parameters in theta, which code for the reflection. And I don't know if there is a general way to decode what is the contribution from the transmission coefficient and from the central charge. Maybe. Yeah, I have to think. Yeah, maybe. Huh? So it was just to show you to use conformal field theory in a more bit more different setup than usual. Well, at least you produce states which are non not at equilibrium, and that maybe you can learn something in non-equilibrium physics from that. I am not sure that you will realize these states in a laboratory, but nevertheless, maybe you will learn something about, in general, about non-equilibrium physics, maybe. Sure, sure, I agree. That's what I said, even for the pump. Free fermion is the first example. You consider free fermions, Dirac, no, even Majorana fermions, and with a reflection coefficient in between. So you just have a free fermion here. So free fermion. So C is 1/2. C is 1/2. But here you have some reflection coefficient. Okay? And in that case, you will have 1/2 due to C, and then the reflection coefficient here. Or the transmission coefficient, and one of the two. No, but actually, it's conformal invariant, but it's Cardi. You see, so for I can just describe this free fermion. If you think about free fermion, when you have, so it's C equal 1/2 and C equal 1/2. So when you look at VL tensor V, right, this is C equal 1/2 times C equal 1/2. Okay? And the rule when you do multiplication is to do addition. So that this is the same thing as C equal 1. Okay? Because the algebra acts additively. C equal 1 is just a U1 symmetry. Okay? It's a free field. So you don't have a U1 symmetry here, but you have a global U1 symmetry. So all the reflection coefficients here, which are induced Bogoliubov transformation on the free fermion, are just the echo Bogoliubov transformation, is just this U1 here. So what we have done is to extend Bogoliubov transformation in a bit more. That's it. What was the question? No. Yeah. Actually, the contact, you wanted the contact with the Cardi formula. So, in conformal field theory, in the Euclidean one, a way to describe, so you want to couple two conformal field theories, so you have domain where you have a conformal field theory, let's say a disk, inside the disk, you have CFT1 here and CFT2 here. Okay? And for Cardi, this one will be the trivial one. So the way usually what is done in a Euclidean field theory is that here you have so V1 times V1 bar, the set of operators. So you will define from a map from the space of bulk field, which are, so that's the bulk field, bulk, in the CFT into one, into a bulk field of the CFT2. So that will happen what happened when you cross that. So you have a defect in the Euclidean field theory, the map like that. Whereas we had something which was mixed, no? So you go from one to the other one as a crossing symmetry, if you want. What I had is something like that. That was my theta, no? Theta was going up, no? So if you look in that direction, that's what you will have, because that's V left times V left bar. So D acts like that. Yeah, it's a crossing relation a bit. But now if you look at the consistency of the theta with the OPE and consistency of D with modular invariance and so on, you don't get the same relation. So seems that there is a differences. But yeah, it's not very far from the usual defect in conformal field theory, but you see, to find them, we could not use that directly because dynamic. I think it's a long way to starting from D, prove that you, once you define the dynamic by theta, you preserve the energy. Because you see, you don't act on the same operator and so on. No. So that was a bit, there was more conformal field theory at the end of the lecture.